Let's discuss Thursday's House hearing on the ABS-CBN franchise with Professor Danilo Arau from the University of the Philippines' College of Mass Communication. Good morning, Professor Arau, and thank you very much for joining us.
Yes, good morning to you, Christian, and to all our listeners and viewers.
Okay, from what we understand, we're now close to the tail end of the House committee hearings on ABS-CBN's application for a new franchise. Now, I'd like to get your thoughts on how you view the hearing so far, what has been proven and or what has been made clear, at least, as far as the allegations against ABS-CBN are concerned.
It's clear that ABS-CBN, as usual, is being singled out, and it makes us wonder why they're prolonging the agony. Why don't they just say that, hey, under this administration, you cannot get a new franchise, so you have to try your luck after 2022. So the problem really is with Congress, and it's clearly an attack on press freedom. Even if you look at the resource persons who are being invited to speak, whether in defense or in criticism of ABS-CBN, you can see the bias towards non-renewal.
But of course, to be fair to the other congressmen, there are also other congressmen who are somehow openly supportive of ABS-CBN's franchise renewal application. But of course, you have at least three or four congressmen who are also openly against the application, or at least somehow leading the charge when it comes to clarifying at least the allegations against ABS-CBN. But what do you think of the of the direction so far?
Well, the direction seems to be toward, as you mentioned a while ago, those who openly oppose the renewal of franchise. So, yes, it's clear. Thank you for pointing it out that there are people who openly support the franchise renewal of ABS-CBN, and that would explain for the about one dozen bills regarding the renewal of franchise. But when I say Congress, it means that as a body, it's still controlled basically by you know who, and that's the problem. When you have a regime that has clear authoritarian tendencies, then it would be able to get what it wants despite the heterogeneous nature of the composition of Congress, because they are in the majority and they can do whatever they want. So it's clearly an issue of impunity, and we have to look at the situation of ABS-CBN as part of the systematic attacks on media. So as you mentioned a while ago, there's that case about Rappler, where it is really at the crosshairs of the administration. And of course, let's not forget the red taping that's continuing against some members of the alternative media. And even among our ranks in the alternative media, there are those who are still in detention, and there are still those who are continuously being threatened by the coercive forces of the state.
Now, you mentioned that term, you know who. I suppose you're referring to President Rodrigo Duterte, who had repeatedly threatened to shut down ABS-CBN. But my question is this. There was a clarification afterwards saying that the president would be neutral when it comes to the House hearings on ABS-CBN's franchise. You think that those threats made by the president before are still the main factor that's keeping Congress, or at least the House committees, from approving the application?
Yes, Duterte saying that he is completely neutral through his spokespersons and through his people, these are just empty rhetoric, because, again, we have to be clear about the historical timeline, in this case pertaining to ABS-CBN. The threat still stands. Duterte is still as vindictive as before, and he is using the opportunity of, given by the COVID-19 pandemic, to really do what he wants. So it's not just an issue of attacks on press freedom. It can be something related to the to the phase out of the jeepney, for example, which is now being done, to the passage of the anti-terrorism bill again, which is impending, awaiting his signature right now. So he is using this particular pandemic to make sure that they would push forward with their agenda. Let's not forget that the ILG is ongoing with its consultation regarding the shift to federalism, although they're using the term revolutionary government right now. So that kind of an atmosphere should be clearly seen as really veiled. It's not a veiled threat anymore against the media. It's a direct attack on the media as well as the people's basic freedom. So that's the thing. It's not an issue of legal technicality or of ABS-CBN allegedly violating certain laws that would result in the non-renewal of franchise. So the law right now, as well as the entire bureaucracy, is being weaponized to make sure that they would get what they want. And by that particular atmosphere, we see the direct manifestation of culture of impunity, and we should not lose sight of that particular context.
Okay, of course, that is one of the clear issues here. You mentioned that already. This is clearly a press freedom issue. Now, of course, how about the other issues thrown against ABS-CBN, for example, labor?
Okay, so it's true that labor is a very serious issue. We're not about to discount that, but of course, the fundamental question remains, okay, even granting for the sake of argument that there were labor violations in the past, does this mean, would this result in the non-renewal of franchise? And remember, it may sound a bit awkward here, but in the dominant media to which ABS-CBN belongs, labor has been a persistent problem. If you look back at history, it's not as if ABS-CBN is the only one with problems regarding contractualization, regarding alleged unfair termination of some of its workers, among many others. So why is it that other networks, when their renewal franchise was up for deliberation, why was labor issue not being discussed? Well, I think the reason there is quite simple. If there are certain cases that would have to be filed against a particular media organization or a particular company outside the media industry, you have to lodge it to the appropriate courts. Okay, it can be the Department of Labor and Employment, it can be the regional trial courts. I mean, anyway, the long and short of it is, if ABS-CBN really has labor issues and really has labor problems, then charge them properly in court, but don't use the franchise renewal as a leverage against a particular network to get what you want. That's what we mean by weaponization. You're trying to use the opportunity to really single out a certain media entity, even if it's clear that others are able to get away with it if we go by the logic of the accusation.
Now, what do you think, excuse me, Professor Arau, of the response coming from other members of the media? We know that there are a lot of members of the media that are very passionate about what's happening here, because clearly to them, they see this not just as an attack on ABS-CBN, but as an attack on the industry, on press freedom as a whole. But how about the other, for example, networks, other broadcast organizations, other media organizations for that matter? Do you sense also that somehow some of them are holding back for fear that they might be next?
Okay, I'm sensing the chilling effect of what ABS-CBN is going through right now. It's just simply looking at the way media coverage is being done in terms of not just analyzing or making sense of the ABS-CBN franchise issue, but even in terms of coverage of the government's handling of the pandemic right now. Hard questions should be asked. Now, to be fair, there are a few journalists out there outside ABS-CBN who are still able to practice the highest normative standards of the profession. But as we are all aware, it all boils down to gatekeeping, and it all boils down to what the owners want. The other news media organizations apparently have owners and gatekeepers who do not, in general, I'm saying this in general terms, they don't want to be at the crosshairs of the current administration because, as you correctly mentioned, they might be next. With regard to the systematic attacks against the media. So that's the disappointing part about the kind of journalism that we have. This is the time to be brave. this is really the time to not just hold the line, but to also sharpen the line, to draw the line between the truth seekers and the fake news peddlers, to draw the line between authoritarianism and the quest and the pursuit for genuine democracy and, you know, genuine press freedom as a cornerstone of democracy. So we should be operating within that perspective. And we call on the media to really ensure that they can maintain the highest standards of the profession. There is reason to be afraid, but all the more that we have to be brave at this particular time. There is a saying in Filipino, ang takot ay nasa isip lamang, right? So we have to operate along the lines of really ensuring that we can still properly shape public opinion despite the current authoritarian tendencies.
And of course, to be fair, of course, you mentioned certain classifications there. So don't forget that there are also fence-sitters at this time. But of course, to be fair to many other journalists, they're very much passionate about what's happening in journalism in general, to journalism in general here in the Philippines. But of course, you have to deal with the owners also, as you correctly mentioned earlier. Now, so far, do you think the public response, the response coming from the media industry, do you think this is enough to, in the face of the pressure coming from the other side, as you mentioned, the government?
Okay, that's a good question. Of course, public pressure could go either way, and we have to look at more quantitative data to buttress whatever argument we may have. We're still waiting for the approval ratings, for the more recent approval ratings of the current president, which may be telltale signs of what we need to do. But going by the behavior on social media, as well as some of the selected mass actions, physical mass actions that provide certain protocols for physical distancing and other safety measures, we can see a high degree of resistance among the ranks of people regarding the authoritarian tendencies. And of course, regarding the renewal of franchise of ABS-CBN. Let's not forget that prior to the lockdown, the Black Friday protests at Sergeant Esguerra, which is in front of the ABS-CBN compound, has resulted in a wide following of people. And the trending topics regarding ABS-CBN franchise renewal, press freedom, anti-terrorism bill, and other issues, these have become trending topics that have not just in the Philippines, but also worldwide. So we are seeing a high degree of activity and, you know, criticism among people. But whether or not such a criticism could translate to actual results, actual renewal of franchise, which is what we want for ABS-CBN, it still remains to be seen. But a silver lining, well, for lack of a better term, I'm sorry for that, but the silver lining in this particular issue is that we could see here a situation where many of the Duterte allies in the House of Representatives are now practically dragging their foot, so to speak, in as far as the hearings are concerned. They don't want to, they are a bit worried about saying direct statements about non-renewal of franchise. So they only have to go through certain legislators like Marcoleta, like Defensor, to mention a few, to really articulate their arguments, no matter how obfuscated and no matter how illogical they may be. Mm-hmm. For a certain legislator to say that ABS-CBN should forget about news and current affairs if their renewal of franchise is granted, it's really very, well, I'm sorry to say, stupid to say the least, because it's not just an issue of violation of the KPP, but rather the practice of journalism in general. It's like saying that, okay, you will renew your franchise as long as you don't practice journalism. I mean, what kind of logic is that? But still, it goes on record in the annals of Congress. So right now, we see certain legislators who are openly supportive of the non-renewal of franchise of ABS-CBN, grasping at straws even if their statements would defy logic. So I think this is the result of people's resistance.
Okay. Actually, we're still waiting for Congressman Mike Defensor to basically respond to those statements that you mentioned. But I'd like to go to the impact on this so-called pressure coming from the government as far as a free press is concerned on the journalists themselves. Of course, this would require content analysis later on. But basically, based on your observation, how do you think, for example, media reports have been responding? Do you sense that somehow there's a lot of self-censorship happening now? People being too careful as far as tweets, reports are concerned, not simply because of accuracy, which is correct, but because of fear that people might, or the government might hit back?
Okay. Subject to a content analysis, as you mentioned, or even a critical discourse analysis of media coverage starting from the lockdown, what I sense based on what I've observed so far would be, number one, the telegraph punches of some networks regarding the coverage of issues. What do we mean by telegraph punches? Of course, the criticism is there, but there are only soft questions that are being asked, and the hard questions are being ignored with regard to press freedom issues and even the general handling of the government regarding the pandemic. Now, while we see certain biting commentaries and certain biting coverage, critical coverage of certain issues, sometimes these are balanced out by or negated by certain coverage that would be very, very soft or very, very trivial even. So that's basically the entire complexion of many coverage of news media organizations. So I think at this point, even if this may sound patronizing, we should somehow commend ABS-CBN for really trying to hold the line, and Rappler even, for trying to hold the line in terms of critical coverage. So among the dominant media, they're doing that. You can say that maybe it's for the reason that they have nothing left to lose, so might as well not hold back anymore. So that's one. However, we have to also point out the fact that the alternative media are still very much around, and despite the threats to the profession, the alternative media are still doing their best in terms of providing critical commentary, in terms of asking the hard questions. So, of course, I have to disclose that I'm part of the alternative media right now, but I hope I don't sound biased when I say this, that right now there is a need for both alternative media and the dominant media to really strengthen their ties, and maybe the reach and the reach, the listenership, and the viewership of the dominant media right now can be maximized by providing certain amplifications of coverage of the alternative media, so that really we can ensure that critical coverage would really happen. Or perhaps another option would be for the members of the dominant media to imitate or to emulate the practices of the alternative media right now, so that we can really properly help in the shaping of public opinion. But regardless of the options or the modes that journalists would take, again, we deliver a simple message that critical coverage is most important right now, especially during this pandemic, and most especially during the authoritarian tendencies of this administration, so that we can expose such nefarious acts.
Okay, Professor Danilo Aro, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much.